Well, Unity's been pretty busy with XR lately, and while this video is not necessarily about the new updates to the XR Toolkit and interaction system, I will end up going over a few of them because they're interesting, and I know some of you have been encountering some issues when trying to get a project up and running in the newest version of Unity. So let's jump into the project, and I'll show you how to do sockets, and then I'll also go through setting up a general VR project so you can see how it's done in 2021.2. So like I said, you can see up here at the top, I'm using Unity 2021.2.6 F1, which is the newest version at the time of this video. And there have been a few changes to the plugins you need for VR. So let's go through those real quick. Just like any other VR project, we're gonna start. Let's open up the window package manager, and I'm gonna dock that over here where the scene view goes. And then we want to navigate to packages, Unity registry. And then you'll see one of the newest updates is you get collections of packages based on what they're used for, which is kind of helpful. So if you could look down at this VR one, there are two packages that they've deemed useful, the Oculus XR plugin and the OpenXR plugin. But you can also get to them just like normal by scrolling all the way down here and finding the XR plugin management. So you can click install here, or we can go up to edit, project settings, dock this one up next to package manager. And then if we scroll all the way down here, go to XR plugin management, you can still install the plugin management there as well. And this is generally how I like to install it. I'll just go to the settings and find XR plugin management and install it. And then here you're prompted with what providers you want. So I usually go with OpenXR. OpenXR, if you're not aware, is the SDK that is the most widely used. So we'll work on the most devices at this current time. And so when you download OpenXR, you're also going to be downloading the new Unity input system, and it's going to prompt you to restart your Unity project. So just hit yes for this. And once that loads back in, you'll notice that over in player, if we scroll down to active input handling, you'll see that we are now on the new system. So if you're using any of the code commands like input, get key down, or any of that kind of thing, you're gonna want to use the old system or at least both. So if you're using any of those kind of commands where it's just input, get key, or on mouse down or anything like that, you'll need to use both in order to use VR. But in VR, you're not usually using keyboard and mice, so I don't generally worry with it. Back in XR plugin management, we're getting a warning here next to OpenXR. And if we click on that, it's going to say we need at least one interaction profile. So we can click the edit button, and that's just going to drop us down from XR plugin management to this OpenXR tab. And what it wants us to do is add an interaction profile here. So let's hit the plus sign, and then you add whatever VR devices you want to be able to build to. So I have a Valve Index and an Oculus Touch, so that's usually what I set my projects up for. I usually add the Vive in here as well. And then if you want to be able to build to Oculus, specifically to your Oculus Quest, you're going to want to go back to XR plugin management. And then if you have installed the Android package in modules, which you can find if you go to Unity Hub, installs, and then click on the three dots here, add modules, and you'll want to download Android build support and the Android SDK and OpenJDK. This will allow you to build your project to the Quest specifically and any other standalone headsets that end up coming out in the next few years. So we have a PC tab, which we're going to try to always open in OpenXR. But if we now have this Android tab, which you got by adding in that module, we can click on Oculus here. I have run into an issue where if you check OpenXR here in the Android tab, if the application tries to open on Oculus, it's just like a flat screen, like you're watching a movie in VR. So if you are running into that issue, just make sure you have Oculus checked over in your Android tab. So now that our XR plugin management is all set up, we want to download one more package. And this is what some of you have been having issues with. If we, just like normal, try to go in and add in the XR Interaction Toolkit by clicking this gear icon, advanced project settings, and then enable pre-release packages. Click I understand, because pre-release packages are not officially released yet, so may have bugs. Go back to project manager. You'll notice that it's still not there. Did they remove the XR Interaction Toolkit? No. It's just hidden right now. So if you want to still download the XR Interaction Toolkit, you're going to click on this plus sign, click next to it, and then we're going to add a package from Git URL. And then this is what you're going to type in. It's going to be com.unity.xr.interaction.toolkit. This is the package name for the Interaction Toolkit. So just type that in, click add, and then it will install the XR Interaction Toolkit. And there it is. And it may prompt you to restart Unity as well. So just click I made a backup, go ahead, because we haven't really started doing anything. It's not going to mess anything up. So now we have the XR Interaction Toolkit. And just like normal, we're going to expand this samples dropdown and import the default input actions. That's going to give us this samples folder with the XR Interaction Toolkit and then whatever version it is. Make sure you're constantly updating your packages. So if we go into Package Manager, you can go to Packages, make sure your in project packages are checked, and make sure you're updating these. So any of them that have an up arrow next to it like this, just make sure you periodically, every time you start a new project, go through and update them. And just a side note, just like we added the XR Interaction Toolkit, all of these packages can be added manually like this. And if you can't seem to find one inside of the Package Manager, they all have a URL that you can type in to download them. Just keep that in mind if Unity one day decides to update the package that you love using and it's not showing up anymore, you can always manually install it. Now let's set up our XR interactions. So in the samples folder, we want to drill all the way down to default input actions. And then we have a few presets here, 5 to be exact. And then if you look over in the inspector panel, there's a button at the top of each one of these presets, and it's add to action-based continuous move provider, add to turn provider, add to action-based controller, and snap turn provider. So we're gonna go through and click all those buttons and make sure you add all of those providers. This will set up your default input actions, so we don't actually have to manually go through and say this button does this and this button does this. This is all set up from the beginning for us to go ahead and jumpstart and use. If you do wanna play around with the interactions, you can double click on this one here and you have the ability to go through and update what clicking on the grip does and what pulling the trigger does and whatnot. Right now, the grip press is select. So you'll see grip pressed, and then activate is the trigger press. Now that we have all those added to their appropriate providers, there's one more thing we need to do before we can start adding things to our scene. So we're gonna go back into project settings and then up in preset manager. I wanna find that. And this is where all those presets that we just added are gonna end up. So you'll be able to see all 5 of them here. And for the controllers, the left and right controller, we want to specify in the filter section right and left. If you don't do this, then you'll only end up seeing one of your controllers because they're both going to be mapped to the left hand. So you need to specify this filter in order for them to be mapped to separate hands. I don't know why it's not set up by default, but this is just something you have to do to make sure they don't map to the same hand and you only end up with one controller. So now we can go back into our scene, right click, go down to XR, and there's no XR rig anymore. It's an XR origin. So all the way up here at the top, and we actually want to add in this XR origin action-based. So the action-based, the difference between XR origin and XR origin action-based is if I click on action-based, it's also gonna give me this XR interaction manager, which is what I want. And on the XR interaction manager, we're gonna add in input action manager, click the drop-down for the action assets, add in one element, and then you can click on this little dot over here on the side and just select your XRI default input actions. And now if we go and look at our XR origin, you'll see it's set up just like the XR rig was, except you have an XR origin component instead of an XR rig component. Unity's kind of updating things, adding in some more features, and so they decided the name change would be good. And just like normal, we can look at our left and right hand controllers and just make sure your left hand has all left hand actions and your right hand has all right hand actions. And something I usually like to do is I'll select both of them by holding down control, selecting the other one, and then going to ray interactor and unchecking anchor control. Anchor control just means you can move whatever object you pick up with the thumbstick, so it like kind of pushes it away and rotates it and whatnot. And I don't like that because I like to move around with my thumbsticks, and so I don't like to move but then also have the object I'm holding kind of drift away from me. So uncheck anchor control. And then here you can also adjust your XR interaction line visual if you would like. So let's get to sockets. How do you use sockets? So I'm going to right click, create a 3D plane object, and then let's install a package to make things a little more fun. On the Unity Asset Store, there is a free fantasy hammer and shield asset that we're going to use. You can just search fantasy hammer and shield on the Unity Asset Store and this should pop up and is free to download. So I'm just going to import this and we're going to use this to actually show off sockets. So I need all of these. I don't need the scene though, so I'm going to uncheck the scene, click import, and that'll give me a folder with the hammer and shield down here in my my project window. So I'm going to drag and drop the hammer into the scene and the shield into the scene. Press F to focus in on them, get a little closer, and then let's kind of bring them up a little bit. I think these will end up being small, but it's fine. One thing we need to do for both of these objects is to add in an anchor point or a grab point, attach point, whatever you want to call it. We're going to go with attach point. And the attach point for the, let's make sure this is on local space. For the hammer needs to be pointing this direction. So when I'm holding it, I want the forward direction of the hammer to be that direction. And then the attach point for the shield, let's create a new game object, is going to be back on the handle here. There we go. That'll work. And then we want both of these to be grabbable. We want both of them to interact with physics. So I'm going to select the top of both of them. Hold down control, select both. And then let's add in a rigid body. And then if these are going to be objects that we grab, we also want to make the mesh colliders convex. That way it's a little more performant when we're picking them up and moving them around and whatnot. Keep in mind that this will fill in all the holes, so it may make your physics a little weird. So you may want to go in and just add in a couple box colliders instead of making the mesh collider convex. And then let's add the mass. Let's make the mass 10 or something like that. And then let's add in a grab interactable. This is for both components. I still have both selected, and you'll see this is your normal grab interactable. So when these are pointed at and selected, all of these pre-configured values will allow me to throw it and pick it up with like a little smoothing effect and whatnot. I'm going to check smooth position and smooth rotation for both. That'll fix any jittering you see when you're holding it. So let's have it so I can either pick up the shield or I can attach it to my arm. Like it's a, I don't know, what is that called? Oh, so let's have it so I can pick up the shield with my hand, or I can just attach it to my arm and I don't have to worry about holding it constantly. So on the XR Origin, left-hand controller, start with the left hand. Let's create a 3D object cube. And this is just going to be our hand. It's going to represent our hand. So we're just going to make very small 0.1, 0.1, 0.1. Same thing for the right-hand controller, new 3D object cube, and 0.1, 0.1, 0.1. There's also a new lock constraints button here. So if you click on this and slide these values up and down, they're all locked together, which is really nice. So you can't scale things out of proportion. So it's a new feature. I love like just seeing the random like updates pop up. It's pretty fun. And then let's add in a sphere for the spot that I can actually attach my shield. So let's add a 3D object sphere, and then we're going to scale this down to 0.1 as well. And then I'm going to click on the blue axis, which is forward, hold down control, and then go back one tick. So holding down control lets you move in increments. So 0.25 increments in this case. And then for the sphere, we don't want it to be an actual collider, because then your shield would just bump into it and not do anything. So we want it to be a trigger. And this will actually allow us to recognize, okay, we have moved our object into this trigger area and thus want to attach it to the socket. And so let's add in a socket interactor. And then we actually want to rotate this socket as well. So let's bring up our move tool and then rotate this around one more. Otherwise, when we attach the shield's going to be pointing forward like through our arm. So that's going to be kind of weird. So we have to attach it and then kind of rotate it. And this is on our left hand. So maybe I'll go the other way so it's not being backwards. And then I'm going to duplicate this sphere, move it down to the right hand, and then rotate it all the way around 180 degrees. Save everything. And then let's hit play and I'll show you how it works. So we have our cube here. And then this is the sphere that represents where our socket interactor is. And so I can pick up my shield and I'm holding it just like normal. But if I try to dock it to this sphere here, so as it enters the collision of this sphere object, we get this little holographic kind of display that shows us where the shield is going to go. And then when I let go, it just snaps to that spot. And so now I have a little shield that's just docked. And so this is a good way you can make inventory kind of systems. So you can make like thigh pouches or like the little Half-Life Alyx wrist sockets or over the shoulder kind of bonework style things. You can do all that with these socket interactors, which are super cool. And so this will work for both. But actually, if you notice, it works for the hammer too. But what if we don't want the hammer to be docked? Because that's kind of weird. Let's fix that really quick. It's actually a relatively new way to go about solving this issue. And that is, inside of our XR socket interactor, there is an interaction layer mask. And so this is just a list of all the different layers that are specific for interaction. So it's not physics layers, it's not tags, it's specifically for things that you can interact with in VR. So we can say we want a shield to be able to be interacted with, and we can use this layer to say, okay, well, I only want a shield to be able to be put in this particular spot. So we only want a shield to be put in this particular spot. So let's go back to the sphere. We say our interaction layer mask is nothing, and then we're going to check shield. Same thing for the other sphere, nothing, and then only allow a shield. And then when we click on our shield, let's go to the XR grab interactable, and then the interaction layer mask for shield is shield. So uncheck, well, it can be default and shield. So it can still interact with everything else like a normal default interaction interactable object, but it also has the layer of shield, and so now we can attach it to our socket interactor. So let's hit play again. And now we can still pick up our shield and attach it to our arm there. But when we try to attach the hammer, it doesn't go, which is perfect. That's exactly what we want. And so, but our shield still works. So perfect. Exactly what we want. And now you can imagine using this kind of thing for a lot of different game mechanics. So you can have a physicalized inventory system with this kind of things. You can have over the shoulder sockets and rib sockets and holsters and thigh sockets and whatever you want. You just have to map it to the XR rig, or you can map it to an inverse kinematic body to the particular joints, and then it's more realistic. You can have a weapon locker, and so each item has a specific spot. You can do keys, so you put a key in a door, you can have this little socket that shows you that, okay, you're inserting the key into the door. And if you want a wider area or a tighter area to be able to say where is the socket going, then all you have to do is adjust this sphere collider or a box collider or whatever you want. Let me turn this plane off so we can see a little better. So we don't necessarily need this mesh here. You can disable the mesh collider and not actually see the sphere at all. So we could just remove the mesh colliders from the sphere, and you still have just this trigger area here. And all you have to do to expand the area that you need to touch in order to attach that socket is to either just press R or the expansion tool over here, or you can click on this handy dandy little thing, and then you are able to grab the point and just kind of drag in whatever direction you want to increase, and that'll help you scale to more specific sizes if you want to have it in relation to something else, like a coat rack or a chessboard. You could have a lot of really tiny sockets on a chessboard, which would be really cool. This is an often overlooked property, but is super, super powerful. So I highly consider you taking into account sockets in your VR game, because it is super handy, super easy to set up. And I hope me walking through the whole process here of using Unity 2021.2 to actually set everything up kind of help clear up any issues you might have been having when you set up your VR project. If you run into issues, you can always leave a comment down below. I am not really able to answer all the comments anymore because the channel has just exploded here in the last year. But if you do run into a specific issue, or you just want to hang out with a lot of other cool VR developers, there is a link down in the description to the Discord. That's where all of us hang out day to day, and you can ask your specific questions and collaborate with other artists and developers and make some pretty cool stuff. If you're interested in getting this specific project or any of the other source code from any of my other projects, consider supporting me on Patreon, helping me keep putting out videos like this. There are not a lot of VR developer channels, so your support on Patreon really helps me to be able to continuously put out these videos. So I really appreciate each and every one of you who are supporting right now. And last thing, as a thank you to all of you who have stuck to the very end, I'm going to be doing a live stream this Saturday, more of like a AMA kind of question and answer your dev questions here on YouTube. And I'm going to be going through how to use sockets live and just generally talking about whatever you guys want to talk about. So come hang out. It's going to be kind of probably around noon Eastern time on Saturday if you're interested in hanging out live. I want to start engaging more with y'all and playing games and doing a lot more live stream kind of stuff, because I think that's a lot more personable. But anyway, enough of me rambling. I hope you have a great rest of your week, and I'll see you in the next one.